stand.
Was wollen wir?
Aus you. Aus you, ich komme wieder in Schmatz. Moshe ben Frachon. וגם, וגם בכור בן זלפה, וגם רפאל בן רחל. רוח השם תחם בגן עדן, תהיה נשמתם צרורה וצרור החיים. We just mentioned the names. What else we're missing? This is the only day we're missing, right?
Okay, this is all the plans for the
army. Okay, yes, yes, we mentioned. And the family?
Kurai.
Kurai. Your family is Kurai, right? You and your wife?
Kurai.
No, no.
Yeah.
The first time? Diana and Eddie Emanuel Kurai. May the Almighty will give you a long life, a healthy life, a happy life, a successful life, especially during such a class and sponsor such a class and such a rainy day. You know, David HaMelech said in Tehillim, God, the Almighty God, בית השם נהלך ברגש. בית השם נהלך ברגש מינים, המון מי זה גם נביא אקסיידת. רגש מינים, התרגשות, פשנט, אנתוזיאזם. When you come into the house of God, you always have to be with רגש, with חיות, with life. But it's another פירוש, it's another explanation. רגש מינים, רש, גימל, שין. In Hebrew, how do you write רגש? רש, גימל, שין. Resh meaning Ruach. God, I'm going to come to you, to your house, even if it's going to be an outside wind. Gimel is standing for Gesher. Even if it's going to be raining outside, I'm still going to come. And Shin, Shelig. Shelig meaning snow. Even if it's going to be snow, I'm always going to come. Bet Hashem Nealech Berakesh meaning a person is supposed to come to Shiur Torah, to a class, to a tefillah, to synagogue. Under any condition. You love it, huh?
Amen.
David HaMelech already hint, God, the Almighty God, I'm here to come under any condition. And for every step that you make, especially tonight, coming in such a rainy day, the Almighty will bless you. V'arikuti lachem beracha. Ad bilidai, ad bilidai, ad bilidai. They said, before we're going to touch the topic, first of all, I'm going to tell you something that I got in a message. It was this guy that came to his father and said, Abba, Abba, I want to get married. I want to get married. Give me your blessing. So the father said, I'm sorry. He said, Abba, I'm sorry for what? I didn't do anything bad. Why I'm sorry? He said, I'm sorry right away. The guy said, why did you say I'm sorry? What did I need? I'm not going to say. So the father said, I'm sorry. 5 minutes later, the child said, Abba, you know what? I'm sorry. He said, now, my dear son, you're ready to get married. He said, what's the connection? He said, if you say I'm sorry for something that you never did, meaning that you're ready to get married. Ladies and gentlemen, we love it. When you marry, you know, how many times, guys, we have to say I'm sorry. I'm walking into my house, I say I'm sorry. She said, my wife said, what you did? I said, nothing. Just said, from now I say I'm ready to. Anything happened is my fault. How many times in life we have to say I'm sorry in a relationship, even though that we didn't do anything bad. What a beautiful message. Maybe it's a joke, but amazing message. If you can say I'm sorry for something that you didn't do, you're ready to get married. Now, what I, before we're going to touch our topic, maybe the most, one of the most sensitive topics, they call it the evil eyes. So many rabbis, so many lectures, so many information. Before we're going to touch the topic, I want to start by saying that, you know, Chazal said, we have here a person that is in the future to be a chatan, future is not time to get married. And me and my wife, I just came back from Miami. Florida, the sunshine state, America. America is driving, open roof, 10 miles an hour. Florida, nobody drives fast, right? You enjoy the sun, Tropicana, fresh breeze all around Florida. You drink Tropicana and you sit it down. I went into Miami and they invite me and my wife, we got an invitation to make a wedding. This woman that got married, Daniela, she's coming to our classes. She used to come, she used to live here for 7 years. 7 years, she never missed one class. For 7 years. And she came and she asked me last year, Rabbi, can I... She didn't find a shidduch. She's not young, she didn't find a shidduch. She said, Rabbi, what do you think that I'm going to move to Miami? I said, Meshaleh makom, Meshaleh mazal. Move, and God will be with you. She moved, and Baruch Hashem, she found a chatan. She is a Mexican, and he is France. He is from France. She is Ashkenaz, and he is Moroccan. And they both met each other in Miami. Listen to that. Only God can make such a shidduch. This is what the sages said. Kasheh zivugo shel adam ki kriyat yam suf. When you're looking for a wife, you have to remember these two rules. The first rule is before you get married. I'm talking to the people that didn't get married yet. The first rule when you're looking for a shidduch is, I'm not talking details. That one is for a different class. Just two rules you have to remember. The first rule is, our sages said, it's difficult to find a match like the spirit of the sea. What is the connection between a match and the spirit of the sea? Very simple. By the way, this is for the many people. If you realize all our father finding the wife and the well, did you realize that? Abraham Avinu, when he was looking for a son to his own son, Yitzchak, where did he find his wife? In the well. Yaakov Avinu, where exactly Yaakov met his wife? In the well. What's that? Moshe Rabbeinu. Where did Moshe Rabbeinu find his wife? In the well. Why water? What's that to do with water?
Endless love.
What's that?
Endless water. Endless love.
What a romantic answer, you know. The rabbi is blushing. I love the romantic answer. It's amazing. But my view of answer, I love it. Okay, endless love. Water is the only item. If you read that, fire is always going up, right? You put a fire, it's always... You take a candle and you put this one, what is the other thing that happened? The fire is going backward, right? Fire by nature is always going down. Water by nature always going down. If you want to have a true definition for Shalom Bayit, bend like a water. Go down. Make yourself humility. Humility is the secret for Shalom Bayit. You know what's the secret of water? You know why a woman when she's going to the mikveh, she's coming down and she's going up pure? What exactly, ladies, you're doing in the mikveh? You're bending and bending and bending. What's the message of bending? Why before Yom Kippur, even a man is very important in Yom Kippur, to go to the mikveh. You know that? It's very important. Even Chama Vadia mentioned it. Why is it important to go to the mikveh? Before you come in to ask Mechilas, Lichav, Kapara, bend yourself. Go to the mikveh. The secret of mikveh, the secret of a happy life, is to bend yourself. Not to come with the attitude. Is my way or the I way? Amen. Which I way? 95? Which one? Terrenpike? Which? My way or the I way? Is it me or you? You know, with such an attitude, you're going to find yourself very fast and I way. Rabotai, the secret, this is for the married. For the one that's looking to get married, you have to remember two words. The first word is, Shidduch is coming from a place that you don't accept it. That you don't accept. Meaning, many shidduchim come out from places, and like this one that we just got married. I was the Mesader Kiddushin, Daniela and Alan. They both came from a whole different, and nobody believed that they were finding themselves in Miami in such a rare situation. You know that what's happened in the spirit of the city? It was three Jews, four opinions. What exactly, when the Jews got stuck in the sea, one group of the Jews said, let's go to the fight. Let's fight against the Egyptians. Another group of the Jews said, surround. That's white flag and that's surround. They're going to kill us anyway. One group said, no, let's pray to Hashem Yitbarach. Let's scream to the Almighty God. And the last group said, let's run in to the corners. Let's run out. Let's run to the desert. It was not even one group that said, let's go to the sea. And where exactly God made the miracle? From the sea. How many times business, you went into university and you studied to become a doctor, to become a lawyer, to become a pharmacist, and happened to be only money you made? From selling watches. And people ask you, why? Why you went to the fair? You went 7 years. Parnassah usually have nothing to do with what you study. Most of us in life find Parnassah from a place that we never believed that this is going to be our job. We went into one direction, and at the end of the day, we find a different Parnassah coming from the places that God designed. Shiduch. I remember in the first wedding that when I just came to New York, I was a rabbi for 7 years in the Syrian community. And they invited me to the first wedding. And you know what's funny? This wedding, the guy was 27. Shmuel was 27 or 28. And he got married. Now, he was looking for Shiduchim for so long, he didn't find. You know where was his wife? Where exactly he find his wife? In the same street, two doors down. Two doors, you know, you can't run. Two, his wife. You know, and you know this woman all his life. They grew up together, he never figured out. And from a place that he never believed that's going to be his wife, over there he got married. He find his wife, two doors down. Meaning, Shiduch is coming from heaven. I know that we have to do effort. But you know what? We have to pray to Hashem and Barach to help us to find our Shiduch. This is one message. And the second message is, you want to get married? Jump over. Jump over. Don't wait. Always be being frightened. Rabbi, it's a good decision, not good decision. To be, not to be, not to be, to be. All day long, we have so many questions. I'm doing the right things. We always, many, many people that I met, especially the ladies, especially getting a cold feet, you know, shivering. Some of them even need to use the pills in order to manage till the wedding. And you know how many ladies came to me? And they're crying, and tears, and you see them the way that they're talking. And I said, ma'am, can I ask you a question? Did you find anything negative in the guy? No. So why are you so frightened? I don't know, Rabbi. I cannot control it. My heart and my emotion and many of us being frightened before we get married. The second advice is, you want to get married? Jump. Jump over and the Almighty will be with you. Make the steps. Make the steps and start finding 100,000 excuses. Why not? No, she is not good because of that. She is not good because of that. Because we're always going to find excuses. It was this guy, this student, that he was a brilliant student. He's a brilliant student. But he had an issue. He never found a shidduch. Never. He went maybe, and he was top guy in the yeshiva. Top guys. Every woman, every father want to have such a son-in-law. He went maybe in 50 shidduchim. All of them want him. He didn't say, he said no to all of them. So the father got tired. He took him to the rabbi. He said, Rabbi, I don't know what to do with my child. They never find a wife. What exactly we can do with them? The rabbi said, don't worry. I have an answer for you. What's the answer? He said, send them to Slavotka. Slavotka the whole time was a yeshiva in the city. It's the city that calls Slavotka. That their job is to work on your humility, to make you humility. They used to send the student to a pharmacist to buy tomato. In purpose. Excuse me, I'm here to buy tomato. Tell the pharmacist, look, are you joking? What is it? In purpose, to embarrass themselves. They used to make fun, why? To kill this arrogant, to kill this midat gahava, this, like a balloon, to make you humility. If the rabbi send them over there for 3 months, the first lady is going to get married. The father sent them to this yeshiva. After 3 months, the father is happy. He said, my dear son, we have a shidduch for you. He went out in a shidduch, she's not good. He went in a second shidduch, she's not good. And number three, she's not good. So the father said, I don't understand. You came back from Slavotka. You're supposed to have humility. He said, Abba, listen to the answer. If before I went over there, before I had humility, she was not good, now that I have humility, definitely she's not good enough. To find, if before I had humility, she was not good, now that I already have humility, meaning to find excuses why not to get married, we can find all the room. Come, your Almighty God, and said, you want to get married? Jump over. Kiyat Yamsuf, meaning, you do your effort and the Almighty will put the blessing on it. Then let's get into our topic. Our topic is one of the difficult topics to deal with. We all make fun of us, but let's be honest, we all believe it. How many of us, every time they're talking about demon eyes, no, it's nonsense. Why people do put red carpet, but every time something. I see people going with tomato, cucumbers, onion, garlic. The guy looks like a smell from a mile, like a garlic. Meow. All day long we eat, we see hamsa and all these things. Meow. The guy, every time you're talking, and nowadays Israelis, you talk to them, especially Moroccan, how much money you're making? It's very hot, very hot, very, very hot. You know why I say hot? The khamsa, the five men, right? Very hot. Gentlemen, you know what? How many of us, we make fun of it, but we don't believe in it. We're all afraid. You know how I want that success? They put iron on a neck and a pig, this guy is putting iron all day long, this guy next to me. How many of them will blame the wife or the husband, especially the wife, that's putting iron on? At night, we're going to sleep, right? Always we're afraid from this action. We all make fun, but we all believe it. Let's be honest. What is Ayahuasca? What is Ivanize? How exactly is it working? Is it real? Is it not real? How exactly we can avoid it? How exactly we can fix it if we already have Ayahuasca? All these questions we're going to try to answer in this class. Ladies and gentlemen, put seatbelt, we're going to fly. Thank you very much for choosing Ellen. Now, I understand damage with punch. You know, especially the young guys here, the one that's going to the gym all day long, the one that look like Popeye. I understand, you know, when you're giving one to your friends, you can hold them, right? I understand. I understand even verbally that you can make damage. When you know, Solomon, the wisest man in the world history said, death and life is in the hand of the tongue. You know, I understand the power of killing a person by speaking gossip, lashon hara, echidut. You can kill a person, you can kill a business of a human being. A customer is coming to you. How is this guy? This thief, gannab. Don't ever do business with him. Wow, you know what he did? You killed him. So I understand the power to hold someone with the hand. I understand the power to kill someone with the mouth. Not only with the hand that they mashma, you know? Today you don't need to speak. You can send a message in a text message or in Facebook, okay, and now, and you kill the guy. Right? Just type. The finger is the finger of a submarine. You send a message, right? Today nobody likes to talk. What do? We send in sour face, you know, this, not smiley face, this face, the one that put Aynara, we send it to the husband, I'm waiting for you at home. Sincerely yours. The guy never comes. Rabbi, my husband doesn't want to come. So how do you want them to come when you put, when you give him this face? The guy is afraid, you know, with this red guy, you know, that's funny. Right? I'm waiting for you. The guy is afraid, maybe she could shut up. The way she sent it to job. So I understand. But one thing I don't understand. How can you hurt someone with the eyes? How can you hurt someone with the eyes? And this is the topic today. The topic is lashon hara. And Rabotai, that's not Ayahuasca. And let's not take it lightly. I will give you, first of all, a few proof. You know the Sefer Bamidbar, book number 4, and the Bible, the 5 books, right? Bereshit, Shemot, Vayikra, Bamidbar, Dvarim. Sefer Bamidbar called Sefer HaPikudim. There's many names to it. There's two names. The second name is the books of counting. Because in these books, God counted the Jewish nation a few times. What? Now, why do you need to count someone a few times? Why do you need to count? Why God need to count us? Why God ask Moshe Rabbeinu, go and count the Jews? Why? Doesn't he know the number? Why do you need to count, sir? You know what's the answer that Rashi said? Mitoch havivut. When you love something, you count it. Right? How many times you have $10,000 or $20,000? I mean, some of you, this is a Jamaica state. Most likely, I'm talking about $200,000. And for instance, it's $10,000. Here is $200,000 and above. You know, how many times you have money in the pocket and you count it, right? You know, some people, the husband is professional, right? They move fast. Now, you see your husband counting $10,000, maybe 10 times at the same time, right? And every time is money. Why you count it 10 times? What's it going to become 20,000? Instead, the same money is going to stay after. You know why you count it? When you love something, you count it. This is nature, the nature of a person. When you love something, you count it. Very simple. God loved the Jewish nation so much, he counted us over and over and over again to prove that in the eyes of God, we are like money. It was one woman that walked in next to the Lubavitcher Rebbe. And the Lubavitcher Rebbe was a very, very old man. He was at that time maybe 88 or 90. And people used to pass. I'm talking about sometime 2,000, 3,000, 5,000 people at night. And he was standing for 14 hours direct. 14 hours. And she said, Rebbe, How can you have power at the age of 60, 86 to stand 14 hours and smiling and pouring wine or giving $1 bill? How do you have the power? We're going to see 10 people? What a line. I'm quitting. What a job. I have 10 people. And each one of them come, give me blessing. 14 hours, sometime every day, doing the other day. So she asked him, you know what's the answer of the Rabbi Chalup? Beautiful answer. He said, ma'am, when you count in a diamonds, you will ever get tired? Ladies, when you count diamonds, right? The diamonds is the best friends of the ladies, right? Did you ever get tired from counting your diamonds? It's not enough. Another one. Imagine yourself, I'm giving you a room full of diamonds. Are you going to go to sleep? Who's sleeping? What is it? 7 days, 24-7, 7-11. The guy is working all day long. Why? Because you have diamonds. So the Rav Chalup said, for me, every Jew is a diamond. Every Jewish person too is another diamond. What a beautiful answer. God loves us so much that he counts us again and again and again. By the way, just to let you know, in general, it's not good to count. It's not good to count. I will tell you, in anything in life, when you have money, when you have merchandise, I know that what I'm telling you is against logic. Because logic-wise, when you make order, you want to know how many boxes you have, right? You're making 100 cases of shoes, 100 cases of watches. You want to know how many cases, right? You want to know which. But in general, you have to know. If you want the blessing of God, before you count, you said, God, please give me a blessing. The Gemara said, after you count, whatever you count, why you limited it? Now you know the number. And for God to change it, he need to do open miracle. Meaning, if somebody hand you money, and you don't know how much money is that, don't count it. Leave it and say, God, please, make miracles. Now, from 10,000, 20,000, 50, God can change the world. Why? This is a hidden miracle. Hidden miracle Hashem is doing on a daily basis. But if you count it, and you know that now you have $10,000, it will never become 20,000. You know why? Because God needs to make open miracle. An open miracle Hashem doesn't do. Very few people, God is doing open miracles. You need to be really righteous. You see, Chacham over there, right? Mechilat that I mentioned it. That none of you will ever have it, will ever know anyone that have it. You know that we are the Jews, we don't call the sickness cancer. How do you call it? They have many names in Yiddish. Yain ha-machala, the machala, the sickness. We don't mention the word cancer. Why you don't mention the word cancer? Why you don't mention the sickness? Because if you mention it, you need open miracle. As long that people doesn't know what a person have, if no one, God forbid, this guy have, there's no one here, have cancer, and nobody know what he have, is a chance that God can make miracle and take it. But if people know what he have, Chacham over there, right, is already too late. Now, you need to be depends on doctors, and the medicine, and I don't know what. Gehenna, we have to pass Gehenna, literally Gehenna. All these medicines that they give today is horrible medicines. Maybe it's going to survive, but the medicine is horrible medicine. You see that? Even sickness. How much more so money? Anything you do in life, don't count. You don't count it, you leave Hashem space to make miracles. The Gemara said, this is a general one. But, in our Torah, when God counting the Jews, you know what God said? Something very rare. He said, don't count the Jews straight. What do? You ask each one of them to give you machzit ha-shekel. Machzit ha-shekel, when you take the money, you count the money. Why? So Rashi right. In order that they're not going to have anger. When you count people, you make anger on the people. In order to avoid evil eyes, the Bible said, in order to avoid, they never count the Jews number-wise. You never count the Jews one, two, three. You never count your children one, two. You know what you do? Until today, we're going into Minyan. How do you know that you have 10 people in the count? How do you know that you have 10? You never count. Did you ever try to count and everybody's going, why you count me? Don't count me. Don't put either. What do we do? Oshia et amecha. Uvarech et achalatecha. Urem unasem ad olam. We have a pasuk. Oshia et amecha. Uvarech et achalatecha. Urem unasem ad olam. That's it. You want a better pasuk? You want a better? This way you're going to remember. Baruch Ata Hashem. Elokeinu Melech HaOlam. Amotzi Lechem Min Haaretz. By the way, only Amotzi is dead. Shehakol Nehem Bidvaro is not dead. What else? Mezonot is not dead. Nine. Only Amotzi. Somebody said why? Because they were Bukhari, made of bread. The Bukhari and bread. The bread is important. Only Amotzi. Baruch Ata Hashem. Elokeinu Melech HaOlam. Boreh Minei Mezonot. Nine. Shehakol Nehem Bidvaro. Nine. Motzi is dead. So if you want to know, if you have 10 people, you count. Until today, we never count people. It was once in the history that somebody counted. Somebody counted the people. Number-wise, you know who did it? David HaMelech, the King David. He had 800,000 soldiers in Israel. And another 500,000 soldiers in Yehuda and Yerushalayim. 1.2 million soldiers. David HaMelech, at the end of his life, the King David insists to count the Jews. And they told him, don't do it. He said, no, do it. I'm the king. He counted the Jews, and what exactly happened? Plague came around, 70,000 soldiers died because of it. Until David HaMelech stood up and said, I'm sorry. God, Almighty God, I made a sin. Chatati. Ani chatati. I made a sin. You never count. So you see that the Torah take Ayin Ra very severe. I will give you many other places from the Torah, just to show you that Ayin Ra is real.
It exists.
I'm just giving you proof. Even God said, don't count the people with numbers. Why? Not to have evil eyes. Let's continue. You know, we have a lachot in Shulchan Aruch. You know that? You never do. If a person has two twins, two baby boys, you don't make Brit Milah in the same time. What do? You leave one of them outside, you do Brit, maybe 10, 15, or half an hour later, you make the other one. Why? Ayin Hara. This is halakha. We don't do two Brit for two babies at the same time. Not to have Ayin Hara. You know that your husband and your son cannot go to the Torah at the same time? You know that two brothers, two of your children cannot go to the Torah? Did you know this halakha? If you want to go, you want to buy Sheni, and you want to buy your brother Shelishi, right? Aliyah. And you know, you buy. You know what they do in the meantime? They put somebody between. You don't put two brothers. You don't put a father and a son. Why? Alaha. Even eyes. Alaha Mishukhan Aruch. This is Alaha.
Even Hasidic people, you ask them how many kids they have, they never answer.
100%. Alaha. Negativity. But this is Alaha Mishukhan Aruch. Just to show you that Alaha is here.
Because they got a number. They don't
want to. No. But when you see, let's see if the father is successful and the son is successful, what do you say? Wow, what a family. Like the father, like the son. So right away, when you put the eyes when they are together, so what do we do? We separate. This way the eyes is not going to be, it's not going to be there. You see? Another one.
They take one, then they let somebody else to go.
Now, I'm going to give you proof from the Torah. You were going to see in the history that everybody was afraid from Ayin Hara. Evil eyes start from not from the time that they count the Jews, much before. Ladies and gentlemen, Sarah Imenu was married with Avraham for so many years. So many years. She never had children. She never had children. She made one mistake. She gave Avraham Avinu her maid, the maid, to get married, right? Today the woman will never do it. Which maid? They give the maid with the knife fall over. Don't do any mistakes. But Sarai Menu did the mistakes. Why Sarai Menu not to say mistake to Sarai Menu? Righteous, the most righteous ladies. But you know, we come Ishmael, all the Arabs came from this horrible child. But anyway, she made that incident. And right away when Hagar had a relation with Abraham, a child came. Sarai Menu didn't like it. You know what she did? She put Ayin Hara. She put eyes. And what exactly happened? That child died. Ishmael is not the first child, it's the second one. How do you know? You remember the first time that Hagar, the wife of Abraham Avinu, the second wife, the maid, ran away. Sarai kicked her out. What the angel said? It will be a day that you're gonna be pregnant and you're gonna have a child. What's my name? She already had a baby. I would say, she said, that daddy baby died. You know why? Sarai Menu put the eyes. She put even eyes and the child died. And even in the second child, Ishmael, you know Ishmael? The grand. How did the Arabs, Hamas, Hezbollah, and all of them, all our enemy, how did they call us cousins, right? They call us cousins. Such a cousins, who need families? Bullshit, what's a cousin? Now these cousins came from Ishmael. Ishmael is the father, right? Ishmael, in the age of 13, his mother ran away from the house. What the Pasuk said? She carried the baby, she carried the son. Tell me, did you ever saw Arabs in the age of 13 that the mother carried him? Arabic child in the age of 3, he carried his mother and his father. He's walking already in the age of 3. Age of 13, why? You know what the sage said? Sarah put eyes, he broke his leg. He had no ability to walk. The first place we see her in Arab, Sarah in Arab. Huh? Second place, let's go to continue. Yitzchak and Abraham. You know the second father? Who is the second father? Yitzchak. Abraham Avinu is taking Yitzchak to what? To the altar. To make barbecue, right? To sacrifice Yitzchak to the Almighty God. It's right? He's taking them to sacrifice himself. What the Pasuk said? Vayashav Avraham lena'arav. After the altar, after the angel said, no, don't do it. Don't kill him. When he went back alone. Where is Yitzchak? Why Yitzchak didn't come back with him? You know why? Avraham Avinu was afraid that people will say, wow, you made yourself, you said. He was afraid from Ayin Hara. He was afraid from even eyes. He told Yitzchak, you don't come with me. Go to a different place. Disappeared for a little while, come later. I don't want people to put bad eyes on you. You see? Second place. Place number three. Yaakov Avinu, two weeks ago, when he sent the children down to Egypt, what Yaakov Avinu telling his own children? What Yaakov Avinu, our father, is telling the children? Banai al titrau. You know what I mean, banai al titrau? Don't show off. Don't go, all of you, in the same gates. When you enter Egypt, go from 10 different gates. Each one is going to go from a different gate. Why? He was afraid from evil eyes. 10 beautiful and successful and strong brothers walking in the same gates. All the people, they put the eye, what's going to happen? I know. So we see in halacha wise, we see in the Torah that evil eyes exist 100%. Abraham Avinu was afraid from Ayin Hara. Yitzchak Avinu was afraid from Ayin Hara. Yaakov Avinu was afraid from Ayin Hara. David HaMelech himself did Ayin Hara to his own people, to our nations. Even though that David HaMelech was the righteous person alive, we see in the history that he repeats, Yaakov Avinu, bless yourself at Tzadik. Ben Porat yourself, Ben Porat Alei, that evil eyes will never control in you. Why? Because Yaakov literally believed in evil eyes. So evil eyes is working, right? Evil eyes is working. So much that Rav, the Gemara said, he was a rabbi by the name Rav, big rabbi. He had the ability to speak with dead people. Imagine if you have the ability to speak with them. You go into the cemetery? Hello. Wake up, I need to have a talk to you. Let's go, we're gonna meet in Starbucks. 7.99 cup of coffee, 7 class. You pay 7.99, you feel good. I don't need it, you can buy outside 150. Now you want to feel cool, right? Imagine if you're talking, this rabbi spoke with all the dead people and listen to the conclusion that the rabbi got. 99% of the people die before time because of evil eyes. Listen to the conclusion. 99% of the people die because of Ayin Hara. The Gemara said, when you're going into a business of a person and the business is flourishing, imagine yourself, you're going to your friends, when the client is balagan and you see, wow, he's successful. Don't stand over there for too long. Don't stand. Why not to stand? You know why? Because if somebody order, well, this nature, by the way, ladies and gentlemen, it's a nature. When you have a mansion, let's say you have a beautiful house, and you invite your friends. What exactly happened? I will tell you. You're not going to believe how bad, but this is the nature. It's not because he's a bad man, this is the nature. The first 5 minutes or 10 minutes, if he's your good friend, he's going to tell you, actually, my brother, you made it. In America, here I come. You deserve it. Allah, I'm so happy for you. The first 10 minutes. After that, he started to look, chandelier, $25,000. This one, another 20. Now he's making calculation. How much money, right? Carpet, 50,000. The house, 3 million. The renovation, another 1.5. Right, he made calculation. And then this is the next 10 minutes. And 10 minutes later, he comes with the questions. And this is where the IRS is coming. Why him and not me? God, why him and not me? Why he deserve? This is nature. The nature is, if he's not your partner, your best friend is coming to your business. When the business is doing good, the first 5 minutes, he will give you credit. The second 5 minutes, he will start with every customer is making $200. I see here 100 customer, already $20,000 in one day. 5 minutes later, God, why him and not me? What make him better for me? You see? Nature. The Gemara said, don't stand up. When your friend business is succeed, don't be there. Don't be there. Be there 1 minute and leave. Don't stand up. Why? By nature, you're going to have jealousy. Nature, you're going to have it. You want to fight? This is that. This is the nature of a human being. Listen to that. How deep is that? It was a rabbi by the name Rabbi Yehuda HaNasi. Listen to that, Rabbi Yehuda HaNasi. When he was a child, him and Rabbi Elazar bar Rabbi Shimon, the son of Rabbi Shimon bar Yochai, when they used to be children, they sat down with all the rabbis. Now children used to sit on the floor, and the rabbi used to sit in a chair, right? In a bench. But these children were so smart, so talented, so gifted, that every question that they asked was like a bomb question. So you know what the rabbi decided? We're going to put them also in the bench. They're going to sit with us. They are not the regular children. They're going to sit with us. The father of Rabbi Yehuda HaNasi, the father of that child came in. And he started to scream. Oh, you, oh, you, oh, you. They said, why are you screaming? He said, I have only one child and you want to kill him? Why you put him on the bench? Put him on the floor. People will look at them. They're going to make even eyes. You want to kill the only child that I have? Right away, they put him back on the floor. You see, even rabbis was afraid from evil eyes. Evil eyes exist. So now we have a solid proof, right? Let's go to the second question. How exactly evil eyes is working? What exactly evil eyes? What is the technique of evil eyes? I will tell you two explanations. Simple and a little deeper. The simple way is, like we said before, you know how evil eyes is working? Jealousy. You come in and you're jealous. The source of evil eyes is literally jealousy. There's no other source. The simple, the basic source, why people put eyes on you? Wow! Why? Because very simple. They're jealous from you. The most common question is, why you have that man? Why you have such a car in that man? Why he's driving such a... Why you have such a watch in that man? Why him? What do you mean, why him? What do you care? He stole it from you, he took your money, what's your business? No, by nature, jealousy. Jealousy creates ayin hara. Because that question that the person is asking, why him and not me, going above straight to heaven. And the question is there. Be'emet, let's check. Why him and not this guy? The question, the angel is asking us a question. You know what, let's open the book. Let's open the book and realize why he have it and this guy not. What make him more righteous? And every time